V. Practical application of the autonomy of the parties. In justifying my preference for the opinion which determines the nationality of corporations by the place of their domicile, I have not concealed from myself its eventual insufficiency, and I have insisted upon the legitimacy of the usage necessary to be made of the choice of the organizers and the signers of the social act, for replacing this criterion or completing its indications. There can often be hesitation between many equally important centers, among which the direction and the administration are divided, difficulty comparable to the famous problem of the seat of sovereignty in the federative states or in those governed according to the principle of the separation of powers. The organizers have at times, on the other hand, the most serious interest, that their corporation may have a nationality other than that of the country where it is domiciled and may depend, for example, on the country between whose frontiers it realizes its most important operations. The most equitable and rational solution is that which seeks, in the first case, to which of the sovereignties in presence, the organizers or the corporation itself have given the preference, and what validates their choice in the second. This solution is also the most judicial, for it is conformable to one of the most anciently established rules of international custom, that of autonomy. It remains to make the application of it in carefully distinguishing the one from the other of these two hypotheses. The determination of the principal social domicile is a question of fact left to the appreciation of the judge and which the plurality of administrative seats will at times render extremely difficult to solve. I have previously spoken of a co-partnership whose three partners, clothed with equal powers, direct, respectively, three commercial houses equally important in three different countries. Not less to the point seems the example of this company of tramways, whose meeting of shareholders and the council of administration sit at Brussels or London, while the delegated administrator, the council of supervision, the technical director, and a council of local administration operate in the country where its exploitation is carried on. In these cases it seems wholly natural to refer oneself to the choice of the organizers or even to that of the representatives of the company already constituted. Let us pass to the second case, in which the autonomy of the will has opportunity to exercise itself. We suppose a corporation in formation whose principal organs of direction are found in a certain country and on which its organizers wish nevertheless to confer a certain other nationality. Have they the right? Is their choice limited, or can it be exercised among certain nationalities and then among which? Under what conditions? I have already answered the first of these questions. Upon one point the second offers no difficulties. The parties had no right to lay aside purely and simply the law by which the corporation is ruled in virtue of the place of its domicile. They could not acquire it by attributing any nationality whatever to this corporation. Their choice can be exercised only to the profit of one of the sovereignties to which the corporation is logically bound by one of its elements, others well understood than its administrative seat, perhaps the act constitutif, the capital or the subscribers, the members, the center of operations. Of these different facts, let us lay aside at first the place where the act constitutif has been passed and the nationality of the members. Very certainly, the organizers or the representatives of the corporation ought not to be allowed to determine its nationality contrary to its domicile according to one or the other of these two last facts, and that for a very simple reason. These facts, we have seen in the first part of this treatise, are capable of producing a relation of dependence between a corporation and a state only by the will, the intention that they imply among the members of establishing this relation. They have meaning only as manifestation of the autonomy of the will. It is then inadmissible that they can render efficacious and legitimate this same autonomy which would thus be to itself its own point of support. If the parties can be allowed to lay aside the competent sovereignty, it is on the condition of substituting another sovereignty with which the corporation has a natural relation and not a relation based on a fact which, insufficient in itself, is of no value except as an index of the will of the parties. Can this natural relation result from the fact that the subscription of the social capital has been effected in a certain country or that the organizers are the domiciled? I have already answered this question in the negative, and I have endeavored to show that this accidental circumstance implies in no respect competency of the legislation and public power to which the territories are submitted, where it has been realized. It can, however, be supposed that the subscribers of the act constitutif of a corporation subordinate their contract to the adoption by this corporation of the nationality of the country where they reside, in the manner that it ought, for example, to be born French, English or never to exist, fault of capital. Without doubt, it will be ordinarily very easy for the organizers to place the social administrative seat in the country whose financial concurrence can be obtained and to attribute thus to the corporation the desired nationality. But a corporation can be supposed to be formed with a view of exploiting lands in Mexico with capital gathered principally in France, of the kind that the success of the issuance demands the assignment in the statutes of the French nationality to this corporation, Although the necessities of the business demand the deliberation of the meetings of the shareholders and the council of administration at the center of exploitation, why could not the parties adopt this combination? The question is precisely to know if it is admissible that their will can freely confer on a corporation the nationality of a country to which it is united by no judicial lien. I have already answered at different times in the negative. The greater part of the rules enjoined by the competent sovereignty relatively to corporations are imposed on the parties who cannot purely and simply then withdraw themselves from them and have the right to derogate from them by their agreements only on the condition of their substituting those which the rival sovereignty has established to which their company is bound, so as to assist by certain of its elements. At the point where we have succeeded, it is easy for us to designate this last. Having thus proceeded by elimination and limited in succession the choice that we had recognized in principle to the parties, we find but a single nationality in favor of which this option can be legitimately exercised. We shall see under what conditions, to the exclusion of the nationality which proceeds normally for the corporation of its administrative seat, that of the principal center of exploitation. Every corporation then puts on, as a general rule, the nationality of the country upon whose territory it has its principal administrative seat, but its organizers possess the power of giving it the nationality of the territory upon which is the principal center of its operations. The positive interest of the corporation will sometimes impose this combination. A very striking example is that of a corporation constituted in the single or principal aim of exploiting a concession granted by a government which subordinates its grant to the adoption of its allegiance. As the necessities of the administration, of the deliberation, of the control demand that its domicile be fixed in a country foreign to that where it exploits this concession, this corporation will thus have a nationality distinct from its domicile. Why not? The choice here is in no wise arbitrary and is not presented, as in internal law, between a particular interest and the law, the jurisdiction, the competent authorities, but indeed between two sovereigns to each of which the corporation is bound in an unequal measure by certain of its elements. The consideration of this interest can then very legitimately join its own force to the attraction exercised by one of the sovereignties and render that one, feeble as it was, predominant. But does it suffice for that an unconditional decision of the organizers? Will these exercise without restriction their faculty of option whatever may be the motive which has made them prefer the sovereignty of the place of exploitation to that of the social domicile? Would it not be possible to here utilize the theory met and laid aside in the preceding chapter which, in defining fraud a derogation of the normally competent law motived by the sole desire of withdrawing oneself from this law and not by a legitimate and serious interest, allows the judge to appreciate in a supreme manner whether the organizers of the corporation had an interest of this kind to establish the social domicile in such country, or, on the contrary, have been pressed to it only by a fraudulent intention. For refuting previously this theory, it was sufficient for me to point out the sophism upon which it rests, and which consists in attributing to the corporation one knows not what nationality different from its own, determined by various facts which I have enumerated, afterwards to seek if its organizers were interested or not in clothing it with its proper nationality, the sole one that it possesses, and whose only generative fact is the domicile. Is it not contradictory? At the point where we have come, is not this definition of fraud exact and admissible? The situation is not at all like that before presented. It was then imagined to withdraw the corporation from the state to which it judicially belonged under the pretext that the founders had organized this dependence in order to defraud one knows not what other states. This was illogical and arbitrary. It is pretended now to maintain it in the domain of this domestic state and allow it to depart from it only in consequence of a consideration drawn from its own interest. The objections heretofore raised have here no more bearing. We have, indeed, determined the nationality of the corporation by the consideration of its domicile in recognizing in its founders the power of conferring on it the nationality of its center of exploitation. Is it not fitting that this exception be justified intrinsically that it have a sufficient judicial reason? And can this name be given to the desire of withdrawing the corporation from the laws of public order, from the authorities, from the jurisdictions of the country where it lives and acts, often perhaps contrary to the evident interests of this company and to those of third parties? The autonomy of the parties will be thus doubly limited, in its choice, for it can bear only upon the nationality of the center of operations, in its motive, for it can be motived only by an interest whose legitimacy ought to be supremely appreciated by the judges. Must we admit this second limitation by the same right as the first? I should almost be tempted to think in this way, although I am well aware of the difficulty that the determination of an element so subjective as the intention of the parties and that of a fact so vague as the legitimate interest of the corporation offers. That which makes me reject this first impression is not only the difficulties of application, the contingency, the arbitrariness of the solution toward which it inclines, but especially this consideration, which cannot be too much insisted on, that the corporation depends in a serious measure on the state between whose frontiers its principal operations are executed. This relation is less important without doubt than that which binds this corporation to the state of its domicile by a veritable appurtenance from which results the greater part of the effects of allegiance. It is sufficient nevertheless that the will of the parties to transform it in subjection can never constitute a fraud. On further consideration, the most judicial and at the same time the wisest opinion, because it is the most simple and that which allows the least place to arbitrariness, seems to be to allow the parties to choose without restriction between the nationality of the domicile and that of the exploitation, the first remaining that of the company in the absence of such an option. The necessity of this restricted option left to the parties has been well understood by Lienkne and Renault, who modify thus the application of their criterion, drawn, it is known, from the center of exploitation in allowing the founders to attribute to the corporation the nationality of the country where it has its center of direction. The system conceived by these eminent authors differs then from that which has just been presented in that one establishes as a rule what the other leaves to the choice of the parties, and reciprocally. Moreover, this concession made by them to the autonomy supposes necessarily that there is no fraud on the part of the founders. It is to be regretted that the limited work of Lienkne and Renault has not permitted them to define what they meant by the word fraud. So far as they shall not have justified it, it will be allowed to remove the serious restriction thus laid upon the choice of the parties. It is that which the members of the Congress of Joint Stock Companies thought, who, however, adhered by their votes to the theory formulated in the following terms, by M. Lienkne and by one of the speakers: the nationality of a joint stock company ought to be determined by the country where it has its principal establishment or by the country of its real social seat, fixed by the statutes. It is seen the terms of this formula being reversed, there is obtained in resume the solution that I have proposed. Both are in accord, at least in that they recognize the same value in the autonomy of the parties. It remains to know by what means this autonomy ought to be practically manifested in order to be admissible and produce its results. How, in other words, is the choice of such social nationality determined and proved by the first shareholders in the case where they could exercise it? To answer this question, let us distinguish again the two hypotheses in which the insufficiency of the criterion of the social nationality is capable of being completed by the choice of the parties. In case of plurality of administrative seats, these can, we know, make the nationality of the corporation depend on one or the other of the establishments of equal importance between which one hesitates to find this seat. They can yet, I have just shown, prefer legitimately the principal center of exploitation to the social domicile for making of it the base of the social nationality. In this last hypothesis, their option is particularly important, for it does nothing less than to check the normally competent sovereignty. In the silence of the statutes, neither the associates nor third contracting parties could be withdrawn from the protection of this sovereignty under the benefit of which some have entered into the company and others have dealt with it. In order to be valid, this choice ought then to be expressed in the act constitutif, concerning only the determination of the veritable social seat which the plurality of establishments of the corporation renders doubtful and ambiguous. It can, it seems, in the silence of the statutes, be referred to the corporation itself acting by its founders, its first members, indeed, after its foundation, by its representatives, and seek in the personality, the acts, the declarations, the attitude of some and of others, what is the establishment which they have, at least in all likelihood, considered as the seat of this domicile, the nationality which they have believed to belong to their company. Indeed, every domicile, as well that of corporations as that of individuals, is constituted by the combination of two elements: the first, material, which depends, we well know, on the founders and is realized in each of the social residences in presence, all supposed of equal importance, in such a manner that it is in the case insufficient for itself; the second, voluntary, which is the choice made of one of these residences by the corporation for their establishing its domicile, choice capable of resulting from many facts and of manifesting itself under no matter what form. It now seems time to appeal to the circumstances which I have rejected as insufficient in themselves to establish the social nationality, because they are of no value except as signs of the choice of a nationality by the corporation, in declaring that by this right it would be, perhaps, the case of utilizing them in the application of the rule of autonomy. These circumstances are the place where the act constitutif has been concluded, the judicial forms according to which it has been passed, the country of subscription, the nationality or domicile of the primitive members, of the subscribers, or of the founders. They could not be invoked the where the will of the parties has not been admitted to exercise itself and have not consequently any direct influence upon the determination of the social nationality. They can, on the contrary, very legitimately serve to manifest to the profit of such residence the existence of the animus, essential condition of the domicile. The judge will have to seek them, to compare them, and discover, by means of this examination and this comparison, that one of these centers of affairs which the corporation has regarded as its veritable seat, delicate and perilous task, but the accomplishment of which will often render easy the possession of the condition exercised by the corporation in the course of its existence. Has it been presented as bound to the legislation, as submitted to the authorities and to the jurisdictions of one of the countries where it possesses one of these residences which we suppose of equal importance? Has it on divers occasions acted accordingly? The law will be applied to it, the case occurring, it will be submitted to the authorities or to the tribunals of the country of the residence which its will has raised to the dignity of domicile. Thus will be applied in this hypothesis, happily very rare and rather theoretical, which at first seemed to exclude it, the rule according to which the nationality of a corporation is established, save the exception resulting from the statutory designation of the center of affairs, by its social domicile.